I'm not an exoplanet person by inclination. I came from studying galaxies, which are, I guess, like exoplanets, but further away. And got distracted from this project, Galaxy Zoo, to building the Zooniverse, which is now a very large collection of more than 100 or so citizen science projects. One of the first things we did, once we got bored of getting people to classify galaxies, was to build a project called Planet Hunters. And Planet Hunters had this very simple, straightforward call to arms from Deborah Fisher and her team, who led the scientific side of this. They said to people, very simply, that with your help, we can look for planets around other stars. And I think a large part of the success of Planet Hunters, which I'm going to get on to talk about, was because of the simplicity of that call to action. Everyone in the world could get excited about trying to find planets out in the Milky Way galaxy. If people could understand what it was that they were being asked to participate in, it's a lesson that we took from Planet Hunters and deployed the citizen science projects again and again and again. It was, I have to say, not at all obvious that Planet Hunters would be a success. In preparing this talk, I found an email I sent to the team the day that we launched, preparing them for the possibility that we were about to waste a huge amount of people's time. After all, the idea of hunting for transits by eye is what we were asking people to do, by the way, is slightly crazy. It's slightly less crazy if you spent time in a big survey and found yourself eyeballing transits. But compared to the sophistication, even then, of machine learning, sort of automated and algorithmic things, it seems like crazy. But my email the day before pointed out that what we were doing was a gamble. We were replacing a bet on the ability to meet machine just occasionally. I said at the time that it may be that no planets are found, but we learned nothing. But that's okay. You know, this was seen by us as a grand experiment, an attempt to try and see whether there was more in the data than was being found automatically. And there's a long history, it turns out, of using volunteers to watch one object pass in front of another. I couldn't resist including the story of Edmund Halley's, I'm in Oxford, Edmund Halley's attempts to record observations of the eclipse. The total eclipse of the sun that took place in 1715. This is the map of the predicted eclipse path that he published. You could buy this, and the text at the bottom that you see there, is, which is too small to read, that text is a description of how to make scientific observations of the eclipse. He was interested in refining his measurements of the solar system. And what's fun about this story is that Halley arranged to make his own observations from London. There it was founded. In Oxford, the University Observatory was founded out. And in Cambridge, the other great centre of astronomy in this country at the time, where it was clear that the astronomers there were, and I quote for records at the time, oppressed by company. And they were unable to make any observations. In other words, so many people turned up to watch the eclipse that they made no serious scientific observations, but 200 or so people from across the country sent Halley observations, and he was able to use those to refine his model of the solar system. So there is a tradition here, and maybe if I knew my Oxford history, I would have expected the success that we found, when we quickly started discovering planets. Of course, you will all know that if you discover planets, you have to make artist impressions, and we had some good ones. This is the planet that we call Planet Hunters 2b. The 10 Earth radii planet of Jupiter in the habitable zone of a sun-like star, and because it's in the habitable zone, we pretended it might be the moon. The discoverers, it was genuinely one of the highlights of my career to send email to the volunteers who had found this and say, well, we found a planet. You found a planet. We now know that this thing exists because of you. And those volunteers included this guy, this is Roy Jackson. He was a 71-year-old retired policeman from Gateshead in the north of England. And he was overjoyed, I think. to be one of the discoverers of this planet. He went on national television to address what it felt like to discover a planet, and he said he was pretty happy. And he was also asked why he chose to start hunting for planets. Maybe it's a question that lots of you have asked yourselves over the last few years, but from what he's answered differently, he said straight down the lines of the television camera and just said, well, there was nothing on television. I think that's the best reason for making a scientific discovery I could think of. But it wasn't just a one-off. We went on and found lots of different systems. Here are some examples. This is a paper from Joe Smith et al., the PhD students at Yale. The blue points here were the planets that we confirmed and then identified around Kepler 289. So this was a star where a planet had already been discovered, and we added our volunteers, added two more. And then I picked this one because it's pretty typical of the system in which planet hunters found planets. We found extra planets here that were missed because, partly because of stellar variability. The star was, I think, in the top 10% of the most variable stars in the original Kepler sample. But also, there were three planets in the system, they're pretty close, they're pretty large. There were large TTVs here, and the original searches weren't sensitive to trying to fit systems with large TTVs. Later on, and in this paper we say, more sophisticated methods were developed that would allow you to find these things automatically. But what's fun is that for a few years we had this back and forth where we would find things with volunteers, and then those working in the automated pipelines would catch up, and then we'd find more and go back and forth. And this kept happening. This is the title page of a more recent paper. This is 2015. This is a group who were inspired by Hans Schwengler, who is a citizen scientist. He heard about the discovery of a planet around WASP 47, the original planet, and realized it was in K2, went and got the data, noticed two additional planets, posted news of this discovery on our discussion board to have that spotted by Andrew Vandenberg, who then, with his team, wrote up the paper a couple of weeks later. So this was a planet hunter's discovery that we knew nothing about until it was published by Andrew and team. I think that's a lot of fun when you've got the citizen scientists doing their own discoveries like that. Overall though, the systematic picture was rather different. This was fun, but here's a figure from Meg Schwan's systematic analysis of how we were doing. So this is the result of putting simulated planets into the data set that we asked people to inspect. Got transit depth on the x-axis, and the fraction found by volunteers on the left. So the really small ones are by design almost impossible to see. And by the time we get to reasonable transit depths, we were finding roughly everything. And what that told us at the time, and it was an important result, I think, was that the current inventory of large planets from the automatic method was pretty much complete. We were adding one or two here or there, but we weren't finding many, many, many new planets. And so while we had volunteers who were making discoveries, if you look at this plot, you might think, but actually we should just hand all of this over to the machines. But I want to point out to you that the planet hunters' discoveries are actually different from the planets found automatically. This is the point that Deborah Fisher made in her WIS talk last year in wherever we were, Denver, I think. It was a conference hall, you know what they're like. So this is the plot, this is from a 2015 paper by Lee Brown. And you've got the period of days and the radius in Jupiter radii on the left, and the dots are Kepler planets, and this is what was found at the time from K1. But the yellow and red were recent planet hunters' discoveries. And so in this particular paper, we did follow up with Adaptive Optics. We managed to confirm seven of the planet candidates. The rest are single or double transits, though some of the single transits were confirmed. But the numbers at the bottom here are from Deborah, and I think they're up to date. So 10% of the long period Kepler planets that have been found come Britain, almost half of the planet candidates that have long period, greater than 600 days, come from our searches, because we're much more sensitive to single transits. Planet Hunters is essentially a single transit search, which we then can stack up into multiple transits as a piece. But our volunteers are looking for individual transits, and that's made us sensitive to this region of parameter space that's really rather difficult to go after in any other way. And so I think there's lasting value here. I think if we were running Kepler again, and we had even the sophisticated techniques that we have now for automatic planet hunting, I still think you would want to run Planet Hunters in order to make sure that you were covering this space correctly. So planet hunting was fun. We also, as a community and alongside our volunteers, got distracted along the way. Many of you will know this light curve. This is KIC 842826, I think, better known as Bojin star or Tabby star, or to our volunteers who first identified it, they knew it as the WTF star, for fairly obvious reasons. It turns out, by the way, if you publish in monthly notices, it's a rule that you have to spell out all acronyms. WTF is a bit of a problem. Frankly, and Co. came up with a solution. And so if you've ever wondered how this paper is called, Where's the Flux? Anyway, I'm looking at the author of this here. So I'm guessing that most of you in the audience know the story of the star, but this is the star that now appears to have a variety of interests and dust clouds that might be fading over the course of the century, but Jason Wright and friends enjoy pointing out might have an alien megastructure hypothesis. I really want to say, I think we now will there. But what I wanted to say about it was two things. One is that these people are citizen scientists. So the author list, in many of the Planet Hunters papers, has begun to merge both professional scientists and citizens. And I also want to point out that the initial analysis of this star came about because of the existence of what was becoming quite a sophisticated community of citizen scientists. These people didn't start off as astronomers. I know Daryl's in the audience, by the way, hey Daryl. These people didn't, for the most part, start off as astronomers or amateur astronomers or even as people with a science background, but people who were drawn in by the simple proposition that we started with, that you can help us find planets around other stars. And then they started to do interesting things. So they discussed this unusual dip that they'd seen. And they started talking about it. They go off and get Kepler data. And Daryl, in particular, starts to talk about the eclipse profile. You can see there's a live shot of him puzzling over the data on there. And my favourite thing is that before any professional astronomers have got involved, we have a proposed model. And I'm guessing that you can't read the details of this, but I love the comment at the end here, which just says the true situation is probably nothing like this. But it seemed a good opportunity to rampantly speculate in paint. More of us do that. I think there's a lesson there. And this early model simulated a lot of the work that Tabby and friends did to follow up on this star. And so we had a realization, something that should have been obvious from the beginning, that suddenly we didn't really have a small Planet Hunters team and a bunch of volunteers who were clicking away and doing all this work. What we had was a whole network of collaborators, people who, to a large extent, could take on more of the work and go further than just look for the individual transits. And that's what I want to talk about for the last 10 minutes, really. And one of the things that did was it inspired different projects. So Ian Crossfield and Jesse Christensen and his university put together Exoplanet Explorers. Here it is. And this shows the output from the Terra search algorithm, where we have a folded candidate transit. And we show people this range of plots and then just say, does this look like a planet to you? Now, as a science communicator, this is crazy, right? I teach people that normal people don't understand graphs. The idea that people would look at grants for fun was crazy when we came to Planet Hunters. The idea that people would look at this sort of thing and be able to say something sensible would seem a stretch in the actual world. So we promoted it on live Australian television. This is me explaining planets to Brian Cox. And a day later, we found some planets. One of our discoverers here is this guy. This is Andrew Gray. He's a car mechanic, and he's an amateur astronomer who took part in the project. His reaction, incidentally, and this showed, if you remember the policeman from the north of England earlier in the talk, this shows the difference between our culture and Australian culture. When Andrew was asked how we would celebrate finding a planet, he said he would drag his telescopes out and have a beer with them. His discovery will be noticed to you. This is the K2138 system, mostly packed around their star. Kevin, I know, is there, but we went looking for Spitzer for a sixth planet, found it, and it doesn't quite hit the resonant chain. So go read up if you're interested in this thing. And the Exoplanet Explorers team have now published, just last week, 28 new candidate planets, which fall roughly where you'd expect on with other K2 candidates. That's what we're looking at here. But nonetheless, 28 new planets, including 9 that are on the belt boundary being rocky, and 1 new multi-planet system. And this catalog's just out in research notes of the AAAS. Now, I said that people look at graphs for fun. That inspired us to do more. It's inspired non-exoplanet astronomy. This is a Zooniverse project called Gravity Spy, which looks at noise from the LIGO and Virgo detectors to help with categorizing noise. So rather than saying, come and look for planets for fun, this says, come and look at noise for fun, and miraculously people do. But coming back to exoplanets astronomy, one of the most remarkable stories is, I think, this one. These are transits of something in front of a star, which in a recent paper, these were suggested to be exo-comet transits. And the story here is really all about the third author on this list, Tom Jacobs, who, as the paper says, decided that he wanted to look for exo-comets. So he, on his own, downloaded and undertook a detailed visual search of every single one of the 201,250 Kepler stars by eye in order to find exoplanet signatures, and he found one. And so I think this is amazing. This person, who does not have a science degree, got involved in this through planet hunters, discovered how to use the tools the newest community have made available, and made the discovery of he managed to work with citizen scientists, with the professional scientists to publish. And so what we've really learned from Planet Hunters is that if you want this kind of citizen-led research, and I think we do, then we need a commitment to open science and a way for people to make a start. And because the data particularly K2 are open, and because the tools that lots of you built and use are open, the exoplanet community provided that open space for people to work in, and Planet Hunters provided a way to stumble into it, so that the starting point wasn't please learn IDL and download these tools, but the starting point was do you see a planet in this picture? And we've even started to fix publishing. Because you'll notice in that previous example, Tom needed a professional team to write up his results. This is a paper published last year by Daryl and Tom, which is their catalogue of single transits in K2 from their analysis of the data, without really having to work through Planet Hunters, and published in research notes, which was a much lower bar than normal papers. So I'm pretty much there. I want to point out that because we think this is an amazing set of things to have happened, we're running a project with TESS, My PhD student Nora Eisner is living here in Oxford, along with a whole cluster of people. And we're doing pretty well. We've already gone through 3.5 million classifications, and that means 15,000 flight curves have each been seen by roughly 10 people. We've reviewed them, and we've already got candidates. Those candidates turn out to be mostly single transits, as you'd expect, or transits around very variable or around binary stars. And about half of them made it into the PC list that haven't been promoted to TOIs, yet we think they look pretty realistic. And so our next plan is to try and do observations and follow up. But I want to end by talking about the community. I'm showing you what I have a picture of the National Gallery in London, which has this imposing front, which is common to many museums. And if you work in the museum world, this causes something called threshold fear. The idea that you won't walk up the steps and go into the gallery unless you already think that there's something in there for you, that you're the kind of person who can engage with art. Now, in science, we have threshold fear by the gallery. Every time anyone says to you, or you tell them you're an astronomer, they say you must be smart, that's threshold fear operated. And yet what we've shown is that the idea that you can find a planet, plus the scaffolding that's universe projects like Planet Hunters and Exoplanet Explorers and Planet Hunters Test provide, plus the ecosystem and tools and openness with which many of you do your science, can break down the entrance and allow an awful lot of people in to play in the wonderful adventure that we're all having in finding exoplanets. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you for laughing at my jokes on the OST gift is holding up a wax sign. I'm really sorry that I'm not very person to all of you. Thank you very much.
Chris, I hope you can hear the applause. We have time for a few questions before lunch.
Hi Chris, it's John, and I'd like to comment that this is a great collaboration and also help the commission. We would get queries from the various discoveries from Planet Hunters, and it was great fun and great and very productive for us to actually go and check for some of these weirder things like 12557548 that the surveying the Mercury sex planet. And the Where's the Buck Star, to go in and check and see what was going on and make sure that they weren't external false positives from some of the data that we weren't aware of. And in reviewing a couple of some of the earlier candidates, it made us think harder and deeper about some of the instrumental noise. And I think it was great to see how Planet Hunters evolved to complement the science and discoveries that the team professionals were not, because they weren't in our level one requirements. So I think it's a great thing, a very good thing, and it helped us as well as it helped the community of citizen scientists.
Additional questions? There's a question in the back.
So I was very interested when you were talking about the sort of back and forth between computers doing analysis and then human beings doing analysis and one sort of catching up to the other. I'm wondering if there's any sort of interesting biases that come out when you compare how a computer does a certain job versus how a group of people do it. If there's some value to having essentially both systems running in tandem to catch maybe weaknesses in the code or just weaknesses in how people analyze data.
So, I don't know if you all can still hear me. I'm finding the microphone quite difficult to hear, I'm afraid. But was that a question about different biases from humans to computers?
Yes, Chris, the question was about the value of having both humans and computers look at the same
data. Yeah. If I'd been there, I'd be boring all of you with the work we're doing across many projects to combine human and machine classification. And there's a really good paper by Daryl Wright from Minnesota on superlative classification, where he has a neural network and a bunch of Zooniverse volunteers. There's a figure in there that just shows you why both are valuable. That if you want consistent, understandable, on the whole, perfectly acceptable classification, the training neural network works brilliant. But on the stuff that's slightly out the ordinary, the volunteers split dramatically, and though the human classifications are much more jagged and stochastic collectively, but you can see why they're picking out the stuff the machine is getting wrong. And so in Darrow's paper, what we showed was that the combination of human and machine outperforms either. I think there's also a second piece to that, which is that if you know you're always going to have a willing crowd of volunteers as a backstop, you can concentrate on training and machine learning so that it works well for most of the data set. You can tell your machine learning people to ignore the data cases, which is their favorite thing to hear. And you can get better performance on most of the data set, knowing that humans are going to be there to say WTF if you deal with the weird stuff. And I think once you start thinking like that, all sorts of possibilities open up. So we'll be doing some of that with tests. I'm interested to collaborate with anyone who wants to use our data for that sort of experiment. And I think that's the future of this sort of thing for many years to come.
Great, we will leave it there. In a moment, I'd like to give one more round of